How many need him on this morning?
How many truly need him on this morning? Lift your hands up and tell the Lord, thank you this morning. Thank you for waking you up. Thank you for starting you on your way. Thank you for keeping the hands of the enemy away from you even on the last night. Thank you, dear Lord. Father, we give you a thank you praise for this morning. For you alone, our worthy. Thank you, dear God. Now, Father God, I pray that you will hide me behind the cross of Calvary. Father God, make me invisible, O God, that they may see you and not me. Anoint these lips of clay on this morning, Lord God, that I may speak as you would have me speak. Lord of glory, have your way in this place. Send your anointing right now. Destroy every yoke, break every chain and every fetter. Father, touch our ears on this morning, that we may hear what thus said the Lord. Touch our eyes, O God, that we may behold your glory. Touch our hearts, that we may be able to receive what you have for us. And we'll be so careful to give you the glory and the honor in Jesus' name. Amen. But good morning. It's good to see your beautiful faces on this morning. We thank God for him being in the midst on today. Remember what happened to us over 20 years ago, I guess, when we had 9/11. And, you know, the question was, what was you doing on that day? Where were you at and what had happened? What were you doing when 9/11 happened? And today we want to take a look at a familiar scripture. We'll be found in the book of Isaiah, the 6th chapter. And just like that was a historical event for us, and we can kind of remember where we were at, we want to take a look at what had happened in the day of Isaiah. And the Bible reads as follows. Oh, thank you. Appreciate that. Beginning in the 6th chapter, starting in the 1st verse, and it reads, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on the throne, high and lifted up, and his train and the robe and his robe filled the temple. Above stood the seraphims, each one had 6 wings. With 2 he covered his face, and with 2 he covered his feet, and with 2 he flew. And one cried to another, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the post of the door was shaken by the voice of him who cried out, and the house was filled with smoke. So I say, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. And when one of the seraphims flew to ears heavy, and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, and they hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and return and be healed. May God add a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of His holy word. The ear that King Uzziah died. Like I forced the same statement a little bit earlier, it kind of really doesn't resonate with us because we weren't in that day. So that's why I kind of use the day of 9/11, where it's something that we all can remember. So with the King Uzziah was the young king who had been ordained to be the king at 16 years old. And King Uzziah reigned for 52 years. And at that point in time, he was a man of God for the most part, and Judah prospered, and everything was real good as he was the king. That was all they knew. A lot of people, just imagine, we had so many presidents in our last 52 years. Just imagine them having one leader. That's all they knew. And they were prosperous. But later on, that same king, towards the end, because he was so used to winning, he was so used to prospering, a false sense of security, I think, fell upon him. Now he had went to, the holy temple, and he decided he was going to burn the incense, and that wasn't his job. And so you see that as he began to die, that it was the beginning of the end for Judah and Israel, because they were split. And now you kind of see that it kind of parallels how we are today. You see people are split, one say one thing, one say another. And I just kind of see us in Israel, America, I would say, in that same light. Anyway, when King Uzziah died, the prophet not only seen that or experienced that his whole world was being shaken up, he was also able to see the Lord sitting on the throne. And he was high, and his train or his robe filled the temple. And above it stood seraphims. So I think this is the only time that you see seraphims in the Bible. But seraphims, when they describe seraphims, they talk about them being fiery ones. Or they kind of look like fiery serpents. And they were the holy ones themselves, but they reverenced God so much that they wouldn't even look at him, but they would cover their eyes or their face with their wings, that they would cover their feet with their wings, and that they would fly around in his midst. And one would cry out to the other saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is filled with his glory." You see in the same with the book of Revelation as well, as all of the elders and all of the angels cry out, "Holy, holy, holy." thing to do, to give him the praise, to worship God, our Father. But what happened was, you know that Isaiah had already been called to the ministry, but really this was kind of the beginning of his own. Even though he'd been doing the work already, you see, he said, "Woe unto me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips." He had already pronounced, he was telling the people of Israel and Judah about their sins and how God, as you see in chapter 5, how God told them that he was going to cut them off, he was going to cut everything down, but he was going to leave the stump. And a shoot, the branch was going to come from the stump. God always leaves a remnant. And so, instead of Isaiah pointing at everybody else's sins, Isaiah up again and pointed himself. My mother told me a long time ago, she said, "Son, if you really point your finger at one person, you got three pointing at you." A lot of times in the church, we want to get everybody clean. I always say this, we try to clean the fish before we catch them. First catch the fish, then we can clean them. But we got it in reverse. So Isaiah begins to deal with himself as he's in the presence of God. He said, "Woe unto me. Do you know on your best day, on the day that you did cut, that you thought right, that you spoke right, that you gave your money away, that you gave your mind to be burning, on your best day, the steel like filthy rags unto God. Your best day, your righteousness is as a filthy rag. All have sinned and fall short of God's glory." Isaiah begins to pronounce a woe on himself. Can you see him falling down in the presence of his maker? It kind of reminds you of how Saul of Tarsus was on his way to go kill the saints of God. Damascus, take the Damascus off of us. Y'all catch that there. And on the way, on the road to Damascus, he was on his way to persecute the saints of God. And he had an encounter with God, with the risen Savior. And he was knocked off his horse and he fell on the ground. And Jesus was like, Saul, Saul. He said, "Who are you, Lord?" And his eye, Jesus. It's hard for you to kick against the bricks. And he told him all the things that he must have suffered for the gospel's sake. Shekinah Glory got a song out called "Yes." He says, she says, "If I really told you what I really wanted from you, would you still say yes?" It's going to hurt. It's going to be some separation. People going to lie. People gonna do all these different things. But would you still say yes? That's the question that we have to ask ourselves. Will we still say yes? So, since the post of the door was shaking, for the voice of him who cried out, for the house was filled with smoke. God is shaking some things up. And when I heard that shaking, scripture came to me in Hebrews 12 chapter. And towards the end, step with what it says. Hebrews chapter 12 says this: "See that you do not refuse him who speaks, for if it did not escape who refused him who spoke to the earth, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him who speaks from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth, but now he has promised, saying yet once more, I will not only shake the earth, but also heaven. Now this, yet once more, indicates the removal of the things that are being shaken, as the things that are made, that the things which cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we are receiving the kingdom, She says this to them, and the seraphims, he says, "But woe to me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips. Not only am I a man of unclean lips, I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips." Frustration can cause you to do a lot of things. You know, this is a hard word, because it causes you to look within yourself. It's causing me to look within myself. You know, I find myself frustrated now, I'm dealing with more and more people, and it's like, dude, do you not get it? You know? And I may say some things that I don't mean, or I might think some things that I don't mean. So I have to look at myself. Not only me, but those that are around me. And this is what he says. He says, "Woe to me, for I'm a dumb, a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of people of unclean lips. For what? My eyes have seen the King. The Lord of hosts." His eyes have seen the Lord of glory, Yahweh. He's seen the Lord Jesus high and lifted. Now we know he didn't see him face to face, but the Bible says that no man has seen God face to face and live. But he's seen his glory. The glory means God's weight. He's weighty, he's heavy. It's not just casual. No, this is God, the God of the universe. And his presence is felt by his people.
Our prayers.
You can't do it on your own. I can't do it. I couldn't stop smoking Newports. I used to smoke cigarettes. He said, the same gospel that I'm giving to you, some people are going to receive it, and some people, it's going to harden their hearts. So out of 10 people you may share the gospel with, only one may be saved. Remember, the God of this world blinded the minds of the people lest they believe. We're fighting a spiritual battle. The song said, this is how I fight my battle. Not with your fist, not with a gun, not with a knife, but we fight on our knees. We fight through prayer. We fight through the blood of Jesus, through the cross of Calvary. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. It said God is hard to show mercy. This
is what we have to do.
Once we surrender to God, give it all to Him, He will complete the work that He started for the foundations of the earth. Let us pray. Our kind and loving Heavenly Father, Father, we thank You for what our eyes have seen this morning and what our ears have heard. Help us, Father God, not only to be hearers of Your word, but doers also. For we do not want to deceive ourselves. Father, we thank You for guiding confidence. Help us to look for it. Help us to look for confirmation. Help us to be just like the angels crying out, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." Lord, You be lifted up. You let Your train fill these temples. Use us, Father God, in a mighty way in these cold and dark world. And we'll give Your name all the glory, honor, and praise in Jesus' name. Amen.